How great is our God.
One more time.
How great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. Oh, we'll see how great is our God. Come, now is the time to work.
Children's church this morning?
I do. Children, come on down. Huh? Huh?
What have you done?
What have I done?
Well, look at your hair.
I can't look at my hair. What?
Your hair is green.
Yeah.
Red. Well, of course, it's got some gray, but what'd you do that for?
Well, something happened, Tom, when I got really, really mad.
Well, it looks awful.
When I got really, really mad, it turned red in places. And then when I wanted something somebody else had, I got green with envy. And then in the blue areas, when I got really, really sad and lonesome, and all my worries and fears that just popped up on my head, I just had all these different colors.
Because
I got
mess.
Mad and fear and worry and upset and sad and lonely, and my hair just turned all these colors.
I can't help you.
But yesterday, I read something for the tweens at our tween party, and some of the women that served thought maybe it might be good to tell y'all about it. And then I thought, you know what? I can do it too. And this is what I'm going to do. Okay? Will you listen? And then I'm going to tell you how I'm going to make my hair go back the regular way. Because anybody in here worry? Did y'all ever worry about? What do you worry about? What do you worry about?
Your hair too.
You're worried about my hair color. Oh. Anybody ever get scared? What do you get scared about?
I get
bed because it's too dark.
Oh, I know, and I do too. It's so dark in that room, I get scared. Anybody else get scared? Monsters, I can't stand monsters. What else do y'all get scared about?
Ghosts.
There's really no ghosts.
In my bedroom, and when I see everything in my bedroom, I think it's monsters or ghosts or anything.
Oh, my goodness. But you know, are you get scared of anything? Okay, does snakes scare you? No? Then you are good. Do you worry about school? You don't worry about tests? Wow, you're good. You're good. Do you? Oh. Okay, well, listen to this. Listen to this. And we're going to act like this is Jesus talking to Cynthia, okay? Cynthia, sit quietly with me. This is Jesus talking. All your fears and worries bubble up to your conscience. So think about this. All my fears, all my worries start bubbling up. And see, it bubbled up, and guess what it did to my hair? It changed colors. So Jesus is saying, sit with me and spend some time with me. And all your fears and worries, they're bubbling up. Oh, did they bubble up? Especially Eddie said something to me the other day. Oh, I had the biggest bubble. And then he says, you know what's going to happen, Cynthia, when you spend time with me? Do you know what's going to happen to all those bubbles? When you spend time with me, Cynthia, all those bubbles?
Bubbles!
What are the bubbles going to do? Pop and disappear. So, all my bubbles are going to
like having a twin.
Okay. I want to give y'all a report. We had one of the most marvelous times yesterday, and I'm so sorry y'all got to miss it. Can I ask those that work the tween for a day stand up? Can I ask those that work the tween for a day to stand up? We had some of the most marvelous young girls that I have ever worked with. And we had, those are these. And then we had younger girls. And it was the most awesome day. We saw young girls' eyes sparkle, laugh, and we just shared love. We started it off telling them that we're here to let them know that we love them, and we ended up telling them that we're here to let them know we love them. We had manicures for them. They created scrub, sea salt scrub. We had photo booths. We had telephone etiquette. We had Sephora. We had poise instructions. We had a special server. We had lunch for them. They got goodie bags, and every one of them got a door prize. And most of these women that you're seeing paid for it all by themselves. So, this is part of labor of love, and we labored, but we found love. And what I hope that y'all will do is you want to join us next year, because the girls came up and said, will you do this next year? We love this. They laughed. And you know what? They're getting ready to start their teen years. They need to know that there's love out there, and they felt it. They had a wonderful time. And we had 22, 23 little girls, and we had 4 outstanding models, and it was just an unbelievable time. And my heart melted with the smiles and the love I felt from them. So I'm praying that y'all will want to be in it with us next year. And the next thing is, we'll give you more information next week. How many circled August 15th on saving the date? Be prepared. Save the date, August 15th. You're going to have an opportunity to serve the Lord with gladness.
Thank you, Cynthia, and our Labor of Love Committee. Carol and Doug, what are y'all holding this morning? Stand up, both of you. And Arena, we need to get you stand up, because they wouldn't be holding them if it wasn't for her. You stand up too. Marina's mama's with her too. Good to have you all today. Pray for Kyle this morning in a special way. And Cody and Kayla, you stand up. Where's Cody and Kayla? Where y'all at? Up there? Well, I can't hardly see you up there. Tonight we're having a bridal shower for Cody and Kayla after church, so everybody stay and be with them. And then on the 16th of August, we're having a baby shower for Taylor Arden Parker. So Parker, remember that. And remember, our awesome August services begin next Sunday night. We'll be at Kingston Pike Baptist Church, and Brother Mike Hawkins will be preaching in that service. Our altar flowers this morning are in memory of Ben Humphrey. So just remember that family this morning in a special way. Also, is Morgan and Ty here?
Morgan and Ty
are officially engaged, I think. So we can congratulate them this morning. Congratulations. Also, want to say thank you for everybody that's prayed for Bobby Carroll, called about her, sent cards, brought food. We appreciate you all so very, very much for the way you've loved us and prayed for Bobby Carroll. She's doing much better. Got her follow-up report this week and is doing good. Got visitation this afternoon. Got visitation this afternoon at 3 o'clock, homebound meeting at this afternoon, following the evening worship service. And our Building and Grounds Committee, don't forget, Building and Grounds Committee, I think, is meeting with Jim and Hobart tonight, so remember that. Any other announcements this morning? Any other announcements? Well, it is good to see each of you here. We had another good number in Sunday school this morning. We were up over 200 again. We look around and see some guests with us today. We're glad you chose to come and worship with us. I want to ask our church family to stand. If you're a guest, you just stay seated. We want to see who you are, where you are, and come and welcome you to church this morning.
Today, would you please stand and let's sing it together.
I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. I've been washed in the fountain, cleansed by His blood. Join us with Jesus as we travel this far. For I'm part of the family of God.
Amen. You can be seated. And I'm glad that we can do some shouting down here, aren't you? For everything that he's done for us. Let's stand together. Let's sing when we all get to heaven.
Sing the wondrous love of Jesus. Sing his mercy and his grace.
I think they deserve a round of applause for that. My name is Jim Creek, and Tom told me not to take too long up here. I'm just a sinner saved by grace. Eddie wanted us to tell a little bit about ourselves. I do have a wife, Sharon. Sharon, would you stand up, sweetie? Yeah. She's the better half of the outfit, I want to tell you that right now. I just want to thank you and tell you how blessed I am. Blessed with this church, with you as church family. with the deacons, with our pastor and his wife, family. We don't realize a lot of times just how blessed we are. And when we all get to heaven, we're going to look at Jesus. What a day that will be. We have a day coming, a new day, as the scripture calls it. And that day is going to be awesome. But yet today should be awesome for us. Because we're living, if we know Christ, in our heaven. Heaven on earth. God bless each one of you. Thank you for your love, your mercy and grace upon our lives. Now, if the ushers would come forward. Oh, by the way, that meeting is 5 o'clock. Got that, Roy? Okay, buddy. Let us pray. Father, thank you for this time together. Thank you for this offering that you just take it and use the monies to glorify you and honor you. Take us as Christians, Lord, and use us in this world. Because this world's dying and going to hell in a handbasket. Let us be that witness. Let us be that light, that salt that you talk about. Just forgive us, Father, where we fail you in so many ways. But in all things, we'll give you praise and honor and glory. Amen.
They're just getting gooder and gooder. Oh, that's a word or not. I want to say just one thing, though. I guess it's probably about, and I may be off on my time, about 3 weeks ago, and I'd been knowing that this engagement's been coming. And Ty, which we've just learned to love and take in as a son, has been a nervous wreck, okay, for weeks and weeks. And Dana would say, he's scared to death to talk to you. So probably a few weeks ago, he left after church one night, late that night, and said, what are you doing tomorrow? I said, going to work. what are you doing for lunch? I'm going to eat lunch. I said, well, could I take you to lunch? Well, I knew what that was all about. Okay? But we had a good talk. And all of Ty's family, if you would, if y'all would stand up, they are all from Missouri, and they come today. They went up to Gatlinburg yesterday and decided they'd go on a river ride with the river rafts. And Ty's mom about lost her. One boat come over top of their boat. So they may not ever come back to Tennessee, okay, anymore. But it's good to have them with us, and we want to sing this song for y'all, I've Just Seen Jesus. We knew he was dead, it is finished, he said. We had watched as his life ebbed away.
Then we all stood around till the guards took him down. Joseph begged for his body that day.
It was late afternoon when we got to the tomb, wrapped his body and sealed up the grave.
So I know how you feel. His death was so real. But please listen and hear what I
his voice I first heard, those kind, gentle words, asking what was my reason for tears.
as a child in his eye, I am here. I've just seen Jesus. I tell you,
we can beat that. And all the people said, I tell you what, we've sung songs about heaven today. Jim was talking about heaven today, and then Tom and Tara singing about I've just seen Jesus. As we were singing those songs about heaven a while ago, you know how the Lord brings things to your mind? I think it was maybe Friday night. Bob Carroll, the guy, going over Tuesday to Waynesville to be with Brenda for her surgery Wednesday morning. Didn't want her to be way over there. And come find out where the hospital is. You've heard the saying, you can't get there from here. Well, trying to find a place to stay, they'd say, well, the nearest place is in Cherokee. It's just about 16 miles away, but it'd take you an hour to get here. Or you can go to Maggie Valley. It's just about 18 miles away, but it'd take you an hour and 20 minutes. So we got a place to stay somewhere this side of Asheville somewhere. Don't even know the name of the place where it's at. But I got an email back, and on the email it said, "Welcome, we're glad you're coming to a little bit of heaven in Asheville, North Carolina." And then in the email it said, "We just want you to know that we've got a room reserved for you," and it gave the name of the place we'll be staying, Quality Inn, somewhere I can't remember where it's at now. But it said, we've got a room reserved for you. And it said, this room is guaranteed with your credit card. It said, we just want you to know that we've got a place waiting for you, and we look forward to seeing you in a little bit of heaven in Asheville, North Carolina. I sat listening to these songs about heaven today, and the thought came to my mind, you know, when I was 12 years old, I asked Jesus to come into my heart, and he sent me a message. He said, I've got your name written down in the Lamb's Book of Life, And he said, I've got a room reserved for you in heaven. Not a little bit of heaven, but heaven. And he said, and don't worry, it's guaranteed by the blood of my son Jesus. And then he said, and I look forward to seeing you when you get here. When I get there, you know what we'll say? We won't talk about the street of gold. We won't talk about the walls of jasper. We'll say, man, I just saw Jesus. I just saw Jesus. Whew. That's enough to make a Baptist shout this morning, isn't it? Take your Bibles, if you would, and turn to the book of Haggai. And this morning we're going to be looking in Haggai chapter 1, verse 1 through 4. Tonight we're going to finish the rest of that first chapter. And this morning I'm going to be talking about spiritual apathy. Tonight I'm going to be sharing with you about a spiritual awakening. All from this first chapter. Look in Haggai chapter 1, and I want to read verses 1 through 4. God's call issued to the people of Judah, and he's issuing to Highland Park Baptist Church, to our nation, to our world today for a spiritual awakening. In the second year of Darius the king, in the sixth month, in the first day of the month, came the word of the Lord by Haggai to the prophet Zerubbabel, the son of Shealtiel, governor of Judah, and to Joshua, the son of Josedech, the high priest, saying, Thus speaketh the Lord of hosts, saying, This people say, The time has not yet come, the time that the Lord's house should be built. Then came the word of the Lord by Haggai the prophet, saying, It is time for you, O ye that dwell in your sealed houses, and this house lie waste. Father, bless the reading of your word today. Father, speak to us today that would not be a church filled with spiritual apathy, but we'd have a church with a desire for a great spiritual awakening, a revival in our life, in this church, in our community, in our nation. Father, pour out your Spirit upon us today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I shared with you that this morning we're going to be looking in the book of Haggai. The book of Haggai is one of the more obscure, I guess is the word I'm trying to say. Books in the Bible. It's one of the minor prophets. And what's unique about the message of the book of Haggai? I don't know if you've ever spent much time in it or not, but it's a unique message. Because unlike the message that the other prophets brought to the people of God that were almost ignored by the people, when Haggai come and preached this message to the people of Judah, it produced a positive response. It resulted in God's people humbling themselves before God and responding to God's word and changing their ways. Does that sound familiar? 2 Chronicles 7:14. If my people. That's you and me. That's those that are called by God's name. Shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways. Then will I hear from heaven and forgive their sin and will heal their land. Folks, that's what's happening in the book of Haggai. Haggai came and preached the message from God. Thus saith the Lord. And the people heard it and humbled themselves and changed their ways. And God not only healed their land, but sent a great spiritual awakening to that time. Folks, what we see happening here is a great spiritual revival in the land of Judah. I've been asking us as a church, Sunday mornings, Sunday nights, Wednesday nights, to gather in the altar to pray. And if you're visiting with us, you probably wondered what was going on this morning. But folks, it's time for us to quit doing business as usual as a church. It's time for us to get out of the habit of doing church the way we've always done it and listen to the voice of God and obey the voice of God. And get on our knees before God and humble ourselves and seek His face. And in praying for a spiritual awakening, in praying for a spiritual revival, if we'll do it sincerely and humbly with an obedient heart, God says, I'll listen to you. And not only will I hear you and listen to you, but I'll give you a spiritual awakening. And I'll heal this old nation that desperately needs a healing. Folks, we have to listen to the voice of God. And you can't listen to the voice of God unless you talk to God. And after you talk to God, you need to listen to Him and obey Him and humble yourself before Him and seek His face, change from our evil ways, so God can do for this church and our community and our nation, I believe, what God desperately wants to do. God doesn't want our nation to be in the spiritual condition and the moral condition that there is. You know, I was reading the book of Haggai the other night, and there was two themes that just jumped out at me. There's two themes that really dominate the message of this book. One is spiritual apathy, and the next one is a spiritual awakening. And this morning, we're going to look at the first. We're going to look at spiritual apathy. Tonight, we're going to look at a spiritual awakening. In 586 B.C., give you a little history lesson. In 586 B.C., Nebuchadnezzar invaded and overthrew Jerusalem and completely destroyed the temple. God's people were taken into captivity, were taken over into Babylon, and there they remained for 70 years. And even though God was punishing them by placing them in exile, folks, you need to understand, God never abandoned them. I believe God's punishing our nation right now. But folks, I want us to understand, God's not abandoned us. God's still God. God's made promises to us if we'll be obedient to Him. God had promised these people that even though they were in captivity, He said it's not going to last forever. He said, in fact, you're just going to be there 70 years. And after 70 years, I'm going to allow you to return to your homeland. You'll be able to rebuild the temple. You'll be able to rebuild the altar and once again offer sacrifices. And even Jerusalem will be restored. Well, 70 years later, God kept that promise. And the Bible says that there were about 50,000 Jews under the leadership of Zerubbabel and Joshua that returned to Jerusalem. And when they got back to Jerusalem, they immediately got to work for God. And they started rebuilding the temple. And they rebuilt the altar. And after the altar was built, then burnt offerings were once again offered on that altar on a daily basis, just like as before. But there were people that were living in that area that didn't like God's people. Sound familiar? The world we live in today? The people were called Samaritans. They were foreigners. They were pagans. And the reason they were there, when God's people were taken exile and had left the area was left vacant, so the Samaritans moved in. Because Christians have left a spiritual void in America, the world has moved in. And they become our enemies. And here's the Samaritans, and the Samaritans come to them and say, you know, we'd like to help you. We'd like to help you rebuild this temple. And God's people said, no, we'll do it ourselves. We'll do God's work ourselves. This is our work. And when they refused the Samaritans' help, the Samaritans got spiteful. And the Samaritans got a little bit mean. And they did all they could do to frustrate the work of God. It's what the world's doing today. The world's doing all it can do out of spite to frustrate the work of God. And you know what the Samaritans did? They terrorized the people. They made them where they were afraid to do the work of God. World's trying to scare the church today. They're trying to threaten us today. I don't know if you read this on the internet or saw it on TV or anything, but there's already been a pastor that's been arrested for refusing to perform a ceremony between a gay couple. He's already been arrested. He's already been threatened. He's getting hate mail. His family has had to been put under protection because of the hate that's going out to them because he stood up for what's right. And the Samaritans were terrorizing the people of God. And not only that, if you read the book of Haggai, they wrote letters. The Samaritans wrote letters to the government. And complained about God's people and eventually succeeded in getting the work of God stopped. That's what the world's doing today, is trying to effectively get the work of God stopped. And you know what happened to the people of Judah? They got discouraged. They got down and out. They didn't have any heart anymore for the work of God. They didn't have any desire to go to work, and the temple was just laying unfinished. All they had was the altar where they could do their daily sacrifices, but the temple of God was just unfinished. For the next 14 years, the work of the temple was totally neglected. And folks, the work of temple building should have been the number one priority of God's people. But the people became filled with apathy. The people had no desire. And they just sat down and did nothing for God. Sound familiar? The foundations of the temple had been laid. The altar was up and running. Sacrifices are being offered on the altar every day. But God's building had come to a standstill. And to understand this from God's perspective, how would you like to live in a house with no roof and no walls? That's what this was. It was just an altar. No roof, no walls, and the people were totally happy with it. So God says, you know what? I think after 14 years, I've been patient enough. So I'm going to send Haggai to my people, and I'm going to shake them up real good, get them out of their spiritual apathy, and I'm going to remind them that they have some spiritual responsibilities to me. Number one is to rebuild my house. Church, we need to get out of our spiritual apathy. And we need to listen to God. as God reminds us, we've got spiritual responsibilities to Him. We're supposed to be building His kingdom. And that's telling people about Jesus. I just read Haggai chapter 1, verses 1 through 4. And if you look at those four verses, you see some reasons, some evidence that there was apathy in those people. Same things in our churches today. The first evidence there's spiritual apathy in your life or in your church is when God's work is being neglected. And folks, God's work is being neglected in the church. We've got time to do anything we want to do, go anywhere we want to go, but when it comes time to doing something for God, we don't have time to do it. We've got the money to buy whatever we want to buy, but when it comes time to put God's tenth in the offering plate, we say, God, we don't have the money to do it. These people had a job to do, and they weren't doing it. And this is where the message started getting a little personal for the people of Judah, and it gets personal for you and me today. Folks, God is challenging us just like He challenged them, that it's time to be about our Father's business. It's time to start building up His kingdom on earth. Church, it's time to get back to doing the work for which the church really exists, and that's building God's temple, building up His kingdom. And I said this Wednesday night, you know, we've got all kinds of ministries, we've got all kinds of programs, we've got all kinds of organizations, and we've got people busy doing this, and we've got people busy doing that. But if our main reason for all that we're doing is not to see people saved, we're wasting our time and energy. Folks, we need to make this a major focus. My prayer is that we would get into this book of Haggai, we'd study it together, and after we study it together, it would cause us to have a responsive heart to the leadership of the Holy Spirit, and we'd be willing to say, have thine own way, Lord, have thine own way in my life. Folks, there's got to be a willingness to change in the areas of our life where we need to change. And Christians, we've got to change if our nation's going to change. We've got to bring our will into alignment with God's will and our lives into alignment with the way God wants us to live our lives. Part of our responsibility as a church today is to be temple builders, church builders. And I'm not talking about building buildings, folks. If people are saved and church is growing, you've got to build buildings. But the temple that He's called us to build is a temple that's not made out of stone or bricks or wood or mortar, but it's composed of living stones, of men and women like you and me who have been saved by the grace of God and build their lives on the foundation stone of the Lord Jesus Christ. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse number 5, it says, ye also are lively stones. Look around Highland Park Baptist Church this morning. Do you see a bunch of lively stones in here this morning? That's what we're supposed to be, folks. We're supposed to be lively stones. Are built up on a spiritual house, a holy priesthood, to offer up spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God by Jesus Christ. That's the reason you and I are here. You and I, folks, as amazing as it may seem, are the building material that God is using to build His church on earth. And that's why we're to keep ourselves holy. That's why we're to keep ourselves righteous. 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 16. I want you to listen to this, church. And what agreement hath the temple of God with idols? For ye are the temple of the living God. As God has said, I will dwell in them. Listen, I will dwell in them and walk in them, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. Folks, God is in us. God's walking with us. God is always with us. We're His people. Why don't we live like it and stand up for Him? In Ephesians chapter 2, verse number 20, Paul is describing believers as those who have been, listen, Ephesians chapter 2, verse number 20, built upon the foundation of the apostles and prophets with Jesus Christ Himself as the chief cornerstone. As every sinner comes to a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ, another stone is added to the spiritual building that God is raising up here on earth. And every one of us, when we're saved, are enlisted to work in the building of God's spiritual kingdom, of seeing sinners being saved and added to the church. That's temple building. That's building His church. It's not building buildings. It's seeing people born again into the family of God. And once we become a part of that building, folks, we're not just to sit around for all eternity like bumps on a log. We are called to be living stones, offering up spiritual sacrifices. We are a Baptist church, but we are to be a spiritual people. And if those living stones aren't willing to share the message, how will people ever come to know Jesus Christ as Savior and Lord of their life? Think about it, folks. If you're not a living stone, then what are you? You're a dead one. Folks, God could do all this by Himself. God doesn't need me, and God doesn't need you. But God has chosen to use you and me as His builders, just as He chose the Jews to be the builders of His temple at the time of Haggai. And every one of us has a responsibility to be involved in the work of building up God's temple. This afternoon, 2 o'clock, we're going to have visitation. I won't be able to be here at 2 o'clock. I'll be preaching a funeral. You need to remember the Stacy Allen family this afternoon. But as temple builders, every one of us ought to have a desire to come and go out and visit and tell people about Jesus. And you say, well, I can't come today at 2 o'clock. Well, there's 7 days in the week, 24 hours in the day, and everybody has people that you can go see, Sunday school class members, other people that you can go and tell people about Jesus. The second sign of spiritual apathy is being content with the status quo. Church, we have become content with the status quo. I heard a guy say the other day, a liberal guy on TV. It's about all you hear anymore. He said, don't worry about Christians. He said, they fussed a little bit when we took prayer out of the school. Now they don't say anything about it. He said, every time something happens, they fuss a little bit, and then they just sit back and go back to business as usual. You know what that is? We become content with the status quo. In verse number 2, listen to what God says. Thus speaketh the Lord of hosts, saying, this people say, the time is not come. God says, it's time for you to get to work. They said, oh, it's not time yet, God. The time that the Lord's house should be built. God says, time to get to work. Oh, it's not time, God. The people had become, and I don't know any better way to say it than just to say this. The people had become fat and happy and become what we call today couch potatoes. And if you're in a church, you're a pew potato, I guess. They had just become content with the status quo. The Jews, day after day, month after month, year after year, kept bringing their sacrifices, laying them on the altar that was setting on a slab of concrete that was laying in the ruins of the temple, and they didn't care. And they did it for 14 years. Folks, listen, God is a patient God. He put up with the Jews for 14 years, but eventually he said, enough's enough. Hey, guy, you go wake them up. And church, I believe he's saying to us today, enough is enough. You need to wake up. And we need to be about our Father's business. Being content with the status quo is a dangerous mindset to get into. And folks, it's destroying our nation. Listen to Deuteronomy chapter 8, verse 11 through 14. I hope I gave this to Kelly. Deuteronomy chapter 8, verses 11 through 14. It says, beware that thou forget not the Lord thy God. Oh, we forgot him. In keeping his commandments and his judgments and his statutes, which I have commanded thee this day. God said, don't forget. He says, lest when thou hast eaten and are full, and hast built goodly houses and dwelt therein. And that's what churches are doing. Building these great, big, beautiful churches, setting down and getting satisfied with the status quo. And when thy herds and flocks multiply, and thy silver and gold is multiplied, and all that thou hast is multiplied, you say, oh, look what I've done, and look what I've accomplished, and look what I have. He says, then thine heart be lifted up, and thou forget the Lord thy God, which brought thee out of the land of Egypt from the house of bondage. Oh, what relevance that passage has for the church today and for our nation today. Folks, we should never get content with status quo. If we do, it means we've stopped growing. It means spiritual apathy has set in. And folks, status quo is not an option for a child of God. We should never be content with our spiritual life. We should never be content with the spiritual condition of our church or our family or our nation, because the Spirit of God is continually moving. It's always moving us toward holiness. It's moving our nation toward holiness. And if we ever become content, we stop listening to the Holy Spirit and we quit growing and we die. Folks, there's no middle ground. One last sign of spiritual apathy, real quickly. It's when God's people make excuses. You hear all kinds of excuses today. Oh, if we had done this as a church, or if we had not done this as a church. Verse number 2 says, the people said, the time's not yet come that the Lord's house should be built. Folks, they're just offering a lame excuse to God for not doing the Lord's work. Spiritual apathy will always cause you to make excuses to God. And we get pretty good at making excuses for not doing what God wants us to do in this busy world. I hear them all the time. I'm guilty of making them sometimes. Folks, there's a reason why we don't have time for the things of God. And I'm going to talk about that tonight. But what does God think of all of our lame excuses as He watches us? We get up in the morning and we go to bed at night. And then we say, God, I don't have any time to pray. I don't have any time to read my Bible. But look at what we do with our time all day long. Folks, we've got time and energy to do anything we want to do except do what God wants us to do. And the same's true with our money. There's three surefire signs that we're in a state of spiritual apathy. One is when we neglect God's work. God's work's being neglected. Number two is when God's people are content with their current state of affairs and spiritual condition, status quo. And number three is when God's people make excuses for not doing what God wants them to do. Folks, are we content in this rut we have found ourselves in spiritually? We've allowed ourselves to get in this spiritual rut. And you know what a rut is, don't you? Have you ever heard the definition of a rut? A rut is a grave with both ends knocked out of it. Folks, we can't keep doing church as normal, as usual. We've got to be building God's house. We've got to be doing all that we do to get people to come to know Jesus as Savior and Lord of the Lord. We've got to get upset when things are just status quo. We can't keep making excuses for not doing what God wants us to do. And we need to begin to search our hearts to see if we've settled for spiritual mediocrity. And I believe we have. And folks, we need to recommit our lives to the Lord Jesus Christ and to His work. We need to say, Father, I want to be about Your business and Your work, and I want to have a desire to be all that You would want me to be. And folks, listen, if you really want to do that, God will help you do it. If you want to have a desire to tell people about Jesus, God will give you that desire. God will give you that power. God will help you do whatever it is He wants you to do because He is the enabler. What is it God is speaking to our hearts today, church? Father, I just pray that You'd bless our church during this time of invitation. If there's one here today that's lost without You, I pray today would be the day they come to know You as Savior and Lord of their life. If there are those who need to come put their life in this church, I pray they'd come and say, God, this is where You're leading me to worship, to serve, to be a part of this family. But Father, my prayer this morning for this invitation, want people to follow Your leadership this morning. Let the Holy Spirit speak to their hearts. But I just pray that we as God's people would just say, God, give us a wake-up call this morning. You've already given it to us. It's all around us in our nation. Every time we pick up the newspaper, turn on the TV, there's a wake-up call for God's church. Come this morning and say, God, You've given me a wake-up call. And I want to come and rededicate my heart and life to You and say, God, I want to be Your faithful servant in this church here on earth. I want to help build up Your church. I want to be a temple builder here on earth. And then ask God to enable you to be and do all that He'd have you to be in all that he'd have you to do. Maybe you have a need, a burden, or a circumstance you need to bring to the altar this morning and just say, Lord, I just want to thank you. Maybe you just want to come and say, Lord, you've been so good to me. You've been my great physician. You've been my healer. Father, you've been so faithful to me. I just want to come praise you. Whatever God's speaking to your heart today, let him have his own way right now. Father, move us as a church today into a closer walk with you. In Jesus' name we pray.